Okay, so now we're getting to the really important stuff, the nitty-gritty, money. Money plays three totally separate roles in a community company negotiation: the costs of negotiation, the types of financial benefits a community can receive, and the management of that money. We're going to look at all three of them in this one video. First, the costs of negotiation. Even in a world with telephones, Skype, email, and other forms of cheap communication, building a community agreement often costs significant money. There is the cost of meetings and transportation, even if most of the meetings happen locally. The community may need to find funding to hire lawyers and specialists and consultants. So communities must calculate how much it'll cost and where the money will come from. That's one reason for being as well-informed and with as knowledgeable a team as possible on your own, so you can cut the costs of specialists. There is internal fundraising among the group. There are some possible outside sources like foundations, universities for free donated advice and expertise, private donors, NGOs, other funding agencies, possibly even the government, although this is not a great idea, but it's a challenge to find the money. Sometimes groups think about looking to the company for the money, but this puts the community in a very difficult, if not impossible, negotiating situation. The individual community negotiators shouldn't be paid by the company or the government for participation because it's necessary not to be beholden to them. The team must be free to negotiate the best possible deal for the community. Second, benefits. The financial benefits from the project. How much money do you ask for, and what's it tied to? Here's the pros and cons of each. First, as mentioned earlier, there are the ongoing costs of the project to the community. You must make that up, plus more. Second, communities need to calculate what, if any, share of the project's tax money they should end up receiving from the national or regional governments. Companies can legitimately think that if your government is getting money from them that's supposed to be given to you, that they shouldn't have to pay twice. You also need to find out what may or may not be legally possible in your country and what, if any, rules limit what you can ask for. Third, it's time to figure out what kinds of payments would be best. This is incredibly tricky and requires a lot of thought, calculation, and guesswork since it assumes you can predict the future, which, of course, no one can. It's also true that how much you can hope to receive will depend on the scale and value of the project and the size of the company and how much money it has behind it. There are different forms of money benefits: bonuses for signing, cash payments, in-kind payments, equity in the company, local taxes and fees, and royalties. You can negotiate different combinations of them. There are pros and cons to each. They start and end at different points in the project and depend on different things. Even if the payments go to the community, there still needs to be discussion with government officials who often seek to cut services and infrastructure expenditures. There is a signing bonus. This doesn't always happen, but it's meant to sweeten the deal and to tie the community over until the project and the royalties and taxes and other payments actually begin. There can be cash payments to individuals. This sounds great, but it's often messy and wasteful because people usually just spend it really quickly, and it doesn't help the community. It's complicated, and the amount is extremely low in bad times when people need it the most. It's unsustainable over time, and the government may try to get some of it back in taxes. So although it is so tempting, communities should try to resist. So the money should go to the community pot. Then, before asking yourselves how you're going to spend it, first ask yourselves, what is the community's appetite for financial risk? How badly do you need the money for basics? What are the most pressing needs? Does the community need the money to be stable from year to year, spread out over the long term, or only for a few short-term goodies? Although it is understandably tempting to get the money up front, the short-term thing is the worst idea. No matter what you tell yourselves or what you may need immediately, it invariably leads to waste and less money than you would otherwise get. Next, ask yourself, What do you want the payments to look like? They come in five forms. First, there is a fixed flat cash payment per year. It's a consistent amount, so you know what you're getting, but it's usually pretty small, and it won't go up in good times, so it's rarely recommended. Second, royalties based on the project's output. This protects you from market swings or inflation over the long run, but it does mean that the production amount, not the market price, determines the amount you receive. In bad times, the company will probably cut production somewhat, and in good times, you won't get any more of the higher prices. Third, royalties based on the value of production, what the international spot market is. In good times, the amount goes up, but it also crashes to earth when times are bad. Fourth, mining payments based on profits. This can be better for companies than communities because sometimes if they don't turn a profit or if they fiddle with the books, they can end up giving you nothing for the community. Fifth, equity in the company, owning a part of the company. In this case, the community will only get money after the project becomes profitable, but it will sit with management and gain experience and information. However, the community may lose or not gain any money if the project fails, and it can be expensive, and the community can be held financially responsible too if anything goes wrong. Also, communities should think about other issues in the calculation, such as payments during mine closure, local taxation — this may have legal issues with the national and regional governments — and adjustments for inflation. In some successful agreements, communities are flexible and open to a sliding scale of payments depending on the current market and profits of the company, with oversight, to ensure that the company stays as long as possible and to hang on to jobs and benefits during a downturn. There are money alternatives. Communities need to calculate the value of money alternatives, other benefits such as infrastructure, development by the company that could be used to develop the community, such as roads, electricity, water, and so on. And these can offset some of the monetary payments. Also, what they call local content, preferential hiring of qualified community members, local business sourcing, plus training to meet company standards, employment opportunities for women, and maybe scholarships and training for young people or workers or local businesses. The company can sometimes help train or improve the skills of individuals and local businesses so they can grow and compete on the broader market. These calculations need to be thought about and debated intensively and very carefully by the community because they'll determine whether or not the project helps the community become more successful in the long term. And third, money management. How will the community spend or use the money? Plan now. You'll probably have years before the money starts coming in, but this, not later, is the moment to do some detailed and costed financial and benefit planning. What are the best, but also the worst, financial possibilities and outcomes? Normal temptation is to spend the money right away. It's such a relief to have some, and there are so many things that need doing. But really, you have to make the money you get sustainable to get you through even the worst times and for the future of the community. If you spend the money and the community doesn't have any more, the company will not have to, and it won't give you any more. So be smart. Who knows if an opportunity like this will come along again? So what would help the community most to be prosperous over the coming decades? Be extremely hard-headed and realistic about this. Your community and your children's futures depend on this. What project would improve life for the long term for the greatest number of people in the community? What projects will be sustainable? For example, building a new football pitch may sound nice, but any jobs will be short-lived, and the pitch won't bring in much money to the community. If you were to start a project tomorrow, and hard times were to affect the amount coming in next year, could you finish and maintain the project? Say you have the money and build a school. Make sure you also have the money for the teachers and equipment during the hard times. Consider possibilities that last. Improved education, improved infrastructure, or if there are trustworthy financial advisors, maybe business development to diversify the local economy. The money should never be used for political purposes, either directly or indirectly. One other option that can be discussed is a so-called rainy day fund, a savings and investment account, closely monitored, that can be occasionally used to smooth over especially hard times. It's different in each place. And always, install a cushion for failure. And finally, ask yourselves, how will the money be managed and by whom? What oversight is in place, not only to make sure the company pays you the correct amount, but to make sure no one at home is tempted to use some of the money for themselves? For this, the community will need backstops to make sure that no one person can handle the money alone, that there is total transparency of all transactions and information, and regular audits. You'll need to have audits done on a regular basis every 2 or 3 years, audits of them and audits of yourself. This sounds very obvious or not important, but money is always so tempting, so oversight is essential.